Hey everyone, Mr. Happy here, and in this video, we're going to be covering the theme or specialty of every character in the launch roster for Dissidia NT. Now, this is not a guide on the characters, but this is the most basic thing you should really know about a character before picking them up, which, unfortunately, at the current time, is not explained all too clearly in the game itself. So without further ado, let's just hop right in. First up, we have the Warrior of Light. Now, the big thing with him is that he is a tank. His EX skill is an AoE taunt, as well as having blocks in his kit. The only true tank in the game, I'd say, so being good at using his blocks is vital for success. Blocking with Shield of Light gives the Warrior of Light a stacking defense buff, as well as increases the bravery damage of the Shield of Light follow-up skill, and his HP attack of Coruscant Saber. Garland's main theme is Overwhelming Force. He gains a stacking bravery damage buff as he lands consistent damage. His EX skill has him grab his opponents and do bravery damage over and over and over again in a small AoE, which can be held for more damage. Therion's main thing is his ability to chain his ground combos together to get different desired effects. For example, most characters in the game have a forward combo, a back combo, and a non-directional combo. That changes depending on the character, but that's at least a basic thing you can come to expect. Therion can chain these together freely for up to 3 hits. For example, most characters will do like an XXX combo or a forward XXX combo. Therion can do X forward X back X or X forward X or back X back X forward X. And he can mix up his combos depending on who's closing in on him or who he's actually fighting. In exchange for this, his aerial attacks are very basic and are mostly just used to either hit people into the wall or get them away from you so you can land on the ground. His EX skill causes his attacks to also absorb enemy HP and increases his movement speed. One of his HP attacks is even a counter attack that can be adjusted using a left stick, but I don't have that one yet, so no footage of it. He can use it to block close range attacks with just the HP button press, block mid range attacks with his forward HP button, and long range attacks with his back HP button. The Emperor's main thing is his ability to control the battlefield. He's able to aim certain spells manually and conjure traps all over the battlefield. His EX skill summons tons of meteors in the target location that can hold enemies in place to land even more attacks. The last meteor itself also prevents them from moving outright. Next up is the Onion Knight, who job changes based on which attacks he uses when in his Onion Knight base form. Physical attacks will transform him into the fast-hitting ninja, and magical attacks will transform him into the mobile spellcasting sage. Using your EX skills randomly assigns a job, or, if you're already transformed into a job, it will transform you into the opposite one. Job changing also restores bravery and HP. Now, certain HP attacks also gain benefits for specific jobs or turn him back into his base job. And his dash attack also allows him to burst dash and get around a little bit faster. Cloud of Darkness, after a set period of time, will empower her next attack, quote, fully charging it to deal more bravery damage. She also has super armor in her kit, so it's very tough to get through her onslaught of attacks. Her EX skill on the first cast also becomes all of your attacks to become fully charged for a short time, and can also be expended at any point to perform an HP attack, meaning that Cloud of Darkness always has 2 HP attacks in her kit. Cecil, or Cecil, whichever you prefer, can start the fight as either Paladin or Dark Knight by pressing square at the character select, or changing between them using his HP attacks or EX skill. The Paladin is a strong aerial fighter, while the Dark Knight is a dangerous ground fighter. Changing form with your EX skill also raises your attack and defense for a short time. Golbez's main theme is avoiding getting hit. He starts the fight with a Shadow Dragon that empowers all of his skills, bravery, HP attacks, and EX attacks. If he takes enough damage, he will lose the dragon, and his EX skill will be replaced with the ability to resummon it. If he already has a Shadow Dragon, his EX attack instead becomes Binding Cold, which will summon an ice orb at the enemy location that'll freeze anybody who touches it. Bartz's main thing is his ability to master all of the jobs that he has. Each of his different skills utilizes a different job. For example, his aerial back attack actually shoots a bow, while his ground base attack attacks as a monk. Landing the same attack more than once causes Bartz to master that job and gain permanent buffs such as increased attack or HP, which basically rewards him for using all of his different attacks in all the different situations that he has. The attack itself also becomes empowered and gets new properties. Even his HP attack that he chooses has a job that can be mastered, so keep that in mind when picking it. His EX skill also buffs allies, more so if he has mastered multiple jobs, and unmastered jobs can be mastered faster while under his EX buff. Xdeath is a specialist who is very capable at handling himself in any situation. By pressing L3, he can swap between three different fighting modes at any point outside of an attack. When in Berserker mode, his attacks are buffed and he gets super armor and a deadly EX skill that rapidly decreases an enemy's bravery if hit. Nullifier mode causes his EX gauge to charge faster, and his combos and EX skill itself will actually lock enemy EX skills from being used. Hexer mode causes his combos to apply debuffs, and his EX skill empowers any debuffs he applies while it is active. His Hexer buff will also carry with you if you change form, and it allows his other forms to also apply debuffs. Terra, after all that confusion with Xdeath, is actually a very simple character. If she doesn't cast a spell for several seconds, the next spell that she casts will be empowered, giving it enhanced properties and damage. Her EX skill also gives her buffs to her own stats, so she's very simple. Your goal is to just combo when possible, but when you run away, just know that there's a big attack coming in your opponent's direction when you're ready. Kefka's main thing is that his attacks are tricky. Some stop and start, some have odd pathing. It can be tedious to dodge his attacks at times. He can also move when casting most of his skills, and most of them can also be charged to be made stronger. His EX skill is the most annoying one in the game if left unchecked. It applies debuffs to anyone in range of him when he casts it, with the number of debuffs increasing if he charges it. This is basically like an AoE bad breath, and well, if you've played Final Fantasy, you probably already don't like bad breath. Cloud's main theme is also simple. He's able to charge almost all of his skills in order to increase their attack properties. He can also sidestep while he is charging, so he doesn't have to commit to the charge if he holds it down for too long. He is capable of going out of his way to dodge. His EX skill reduces these charge times and increases his defense. The next two can be technically difficult to master. Sephiroth is up next, and he is capable of canceling the startup animation on his dash if timed properly at the end of certain combos, giving him better chasing or escaping options. The frame can be hard to hit until you've gotten a lot of practice on him, so if you plan on playing a lot of Sephiroth, you're probably going to want to go out of your way to practice this in a training mode first. EX skills also slow movement speed of anyone around him by quite a bit. Squall might be the most technically difficult to master for his best output. Squall has his triggers from Final Fantasy VIII, basically meaning that if you time his attack button presses at the right time during individual hits of a combo, he'll do a Gunblade trigger, dealing additional bravery damage. His back X attacks are also designed to allow him to cancel into another combo, so they can almost act as an extra hit inside of the combo itself, or be used as gap closers. His EX skill has him junction magic from his opponent, giving him buffs depending on what fighting type his enemy is that he uses it on. Its duration also changes based on the distance away when used. Ultimisha is a little bit like Garland. She gains a stacking buff to her bravery damage when she lands multiple attacks in quick succession. She can also move when casting almost all of her skills, including her unique EX skill and HP attacks. Her EX skill attack fires a gradually expanding orb of darkness that eventually explodes at the target location. Zidane's main thing is that he's a thief. He can actually steal the attack, defense, and movement speed of enemies with his dash attack. His EX skill buffs his steel's damage, increases his dash stamina, and removes any debuffs on him upon use. Kuja's primary property is buffing himself and his allies. His EX skill gradually buffs him and his allies more and more, capping at 3 uses when he enters trance. He also has a variety of vertical attack options, but providing those buffs and assassinating opponents at the same time is the big thing you're going to want to pick Kuja for. Unlike most of the other characters, Tidus doesn't really have any super special properties. His main thing is that most of his bravery attacks are only able to be used while dashing, and he has combos that disable the enemy's ability to recover during the combo, making him excellent at setting up allies to decimate foes. His EX skill not only attacks his enemy, but also fully resets his dash gauge if he lands the first hit, while also increasing its max value and restoration rate. Jekt is the combo fiend. His EX skill allows him to reset his attacks mid-combo, extending his combos for more bravery damage. His EX skill can only be used to cancel into other bravery attacks, not HP attacks. He can also parry enemy bravery attacks, including projectiles. Parrying a melee attack will also stagger his opponent and open it up to a barrage of attacks. Shantotto is pretty straightforward. She fights with overwhelming magical force. On their own, her attacks are pretty good, but she can't move while using them, and at times it can feel kind of slow. When she takes enough HP damage, though, she gains a movement speed buff and the ability to move while casting and use empowered versions of her spells that disable an enemy's ability to recover during the combo. Her EX skill makes her invincible and fires a line projectile at enemies for bravery damage. Vaughn is up next, and he is the only character in the game capable of equipping two different HP attacks. When he hits opponents with enough of the first HP attack, he gains the ability to trigger a concurrence, causing HP attacks 1 and 2 to combo together for additional damage. His EX, when held down, allows him to charge his bravery. When you release the button, it will lock his bravery value to the end number for a set period of time. If he gets this high enough, he can try to go around one-shotting people if you leave him open to it. Lightning is a highly versatile assassin. She is able to swap between two different paradigms when you press L3 outside of your attacks. The two paradigms she has are Ravager and Commando. Ravager is a mid-range caster, while Commando is an upfront physical fighter. Useful for adjusting your fighting situation or setting up combos for yourself or allies. Her EX skill is Army of One, which deals bravery damage and heals you per hit landed. Next up we have Shtola, which has a bunch of different things you need to keep track of. All of her spells apply debuffs such as decreased movement speed, bravery damage over time, or binding opponents in place. She can also cancel recovery frames on her own bravery attacks to activate her next skill even faster, allowing her to chain spells together in rapid succession. Her EX skill can be charged to create a large bubble around her location. This bubble gradually generates bravery and restores HP to any allies inside of it. Next up is another new boy on the block, and that of Noctis, who is able to warp around the arena using his EX skill. His EX skill is Warp Strike, and it can hold up to 3 charges, which can be aimed using the left stick. This allows him to go for mix-ups, dodge attacks, or just close the gap between his opponents. When he takes HP damage, the Armiger activates, empowering his bravery attacks to deal additional bravery damage. Kane is up next, and I think you already know what this Dragoon is doing. His main thing is his ability to jump, jump, jump. His EX skill is Jump, which gradually charges up to 3 levels. At level 1, it simply does bravery damage, nothing crazy. At level 2, it not only does bravery damage, but additionally grants a buff that increases the number of times you can jump using your normal jump button, you know, the circle button. At level 3, it keeps the buff aspect, but also changes the damage type to HP damage, essentially giving Kane 2 HP attacks no matter what if he lets this charge up to level 3. This gives Kane a lot of vertical control over the arena, and also the added threat of keeping track of when the last time he used jump was and if it's going to be an HP attack next time. Next up we have Ramza, who is able to charge his unique EX skill by holding a charge button when it's not full, somewhat akin to how Gabranth used to do it in the old Dissidia games. Once full, Ramza can tap the EX button to just buff himself, or hold the EX button to grant his allies tons of buffs instead. When he uses the personal buff, he not only gains attack potency and movement speed, but his attacks also become empowered, preventing enemies from recovering during your combos and allowing him to team up with his allies more effectively. Finally, we come down to Ace. Every few seconds, Ace can draw a randomly colored card from his deck, holding up to a maximum of 4 cards. When he holds the EX button instead, it expends his cards and performs a different attack depending on which color card he has the most of. If he only has one of each card, he'll use the most recent one that he pulled. His red cards deal bravery damage, gaining strength up to a maximum of 3 cards, which will be true for all the cards we say from now on. Black cards bind on hit, with the AoE and duration of the bind gaining strength with more cards. Blue cards restore ally HP and bravery, increasing with the amount of blue cards you have. And finally, his yellow cards provide stat buffs to nearby allies, enhancing the buffs with more yellow cards. Adapting your situation to what cards you pull is going to be important if you want to perform well on Ace. And with that, we've done a very brief overview on all the different characters in the game. In case you're wondering where I got this information, I'll include a source in the description of the video. It's basically a website that Square Enix posted officially, which details all of the abilities that each of the characters have and what their intended effect is. This includes the HP attacks that aren't in the open beta, so you can scope some of those out as well. Oh, there's no video representation. Personally, I think this information should be in the game, but until it is, I'm going to make videos on it. So thank you for watching, be sure to like, favorite, subscribe, and share, and stay tuned for more Dissidia Final Fantasy NT. I'll see you guys in the next one, and until then, take care.